Right, hello again, everyone. Here we are. We've made it to the final chunk of the day. So thanks for joining us again and congratulations to anyone who's stayed the course with us. For the final panel discussion of today's conference, we're going to be opening up the conversation just a little bit more in Beyond the Buffer, Piecing Together Mosaic Habitats. And I'm really pleased to have our Director of Communications and Advocacy at the Rivers Trust, Tessa Wardley, who's going to chair this session. So thank you, Tessa.
Thank you. And good afternoon and welcome everyone to the final session of the day, which is called Beyond the Buffer. So I'm Tessa Wardley. I'm Director of Communications and Advocacy at the Rivers Trust, and I'll be chairing the session. We've heard a lot about buffers and the opportunities and challenges that this session will be talking to three people from three different organisations that are hoping to deliver benefits beyond the buffers. So the three panellists we have here today are Emma Rotherow from the Floodplain Meadow Partnership, Guy Harris from the Findhorn Watershed Initiative, and Eva Bishop from Beaver Trust. In a few moments, I'll ask each of them to introduce themselves and their interests. And then I'm very excited to announce that we'll be premiering the Beaver Trust animation on river buffers. And then after that, we'll have some time for discussion and debate. So if there's anything that you'd like to ask these panelists or feed in, then please put that in the Q&A. And I'll do my best to kind of bring that in to the conversation as we go. So first of all, I'm going to just quickly share some slides for everyone to talk to. So if Emma, if you would like to go first, I'll put your slide up, hopefully.
Thank you, Tessa. Is that okay? Can you hear me?
Yep, we can hear you.
Okay, great. Hi, my name is Emma Rotherow and I manage the Floodplain Meadows Partnership based at the Open University. So Floodplain Meadows are wildflower meadows in the floodplain, and the top left image shows a fabulous meadow in Wiltshire. They're cut for hay annually, as shown in the bottom left image here, and often have aftermath grazing in the autumn, or sometimes instead a second hay cut. They have evolved through the need to keep animals fed over winter to provide meat, clothing, dairy products and transport. Historic research shows they used to be very common in floodplains as they're naturally fertilised by flood sediments, meaning they can sustain a productive hay crop with no other inputs. The annual cycle of flood, growth of the hay crop and mowing has led to one of the most species-rich grassland habitats in the UK. Our research at the Floodplain Meadows Partnership shows they can store more than 200 tonnes of carbon per hectare in their deep soils. And the bottom right image here shows how the depth and diversity of root systems of floodplain meadow species fills up the space in deep floodplain soils, distributing carbon throughout the profile. Floodplain meadows can export typically between 3 and 9 kilograms per hectare of phosphorus in the hay crop, acting as a phosphorus pump in the catchment. They will help slow the flow of floodwaters and filter sediments, storing water in their well-structured soils. However, species-rich floodplain meadows are now very rare. Fewer than 3,000 hectares remain in England and Wales. 70% of floodplains are now in arable or intensive agricultural use, and 42% of floodplains are no longer connected to their rivers. So restoration of floodplain meadows results in sustainable agricultural use of the floodplain, storing carbon and water, pumping phosphorus and delivering biodiversity. And reflecting these benefits, DEFRA have announced a stewardship payment rate of £1,040 per hectare in England for floodplain meadow restoration. So I'm here to promote floodplain meadows as a sustainable agricultural option in floodplains that doesn't need additional buffering. Not all agriculture is bad. Our species-rich grasslands have evolved through and primarily rely on agriculture. We've done lots of research on floodplain meadows and visited many sites across many catchments. We've recently started a project focusing specifically in Wales as well. So if you want to explore floodplain meadow restoration at a catchment or site-based scale, please look at our website and come and talk to us. And that's my introduction. Thank you, Tessa. I'm going to pass on to Guy.
Thank you, Emma. Yes, and thank you very much for having me. That sounds really interesting. I'm from the Findhorn Man and Lossy Rivers Trust up in the northeast of Scotland. I work on a project called the Findhorn Watershed Initiative, which is a landscape scale catchment initiative, about 1300 kilometers squared from the Monolea up just north of the Cairngorms National Park, running for about 70 miles downstream all the way out 3 miles into the Murray Firth. We've got sort of three main areas that we're focusing on: nature recovery and all the things we've been talking about today, hoping to create a sort of mosaic of nature-rich habitats across the catchment, with that core lifeline of the river being the driving force behind that. We've got connected communities, and obviously that's super important as we move forward, trying to encourage people to look after the landscape and really buy into the projects we're working with. And then finally, a regenerative rural economy, allowing people to utilise this land in a way that benefits the river, but also keeps people in jobs in this rural landscape. So you can see there sort of a characteristic of our upper catchment. It's heavily dominated by grouse moors and deer management. And so often our conversation spans much more broadly than the river buffer and into land management more widely. Yes, I think that'll do for me for now. I'll hand over to Eva, and I'm excited to see this new little film. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I'm Eva Bishop. I work at Beaver Trust, where our focus is reintroducing beavers to regenerate landscapes. Beavers can help mitigate flooding, drought, improve water quality and restore biodiversity. And they even help people's mental health, given beaver wetlands more wild feel. Our team at the Trust undertakes site feasibility studies, beaver management activities and advice, research, a lot of communications and education, as well as policy input. And what we find is that land use is, well, what we all know, I think, is land use is one of the biggest cross-sector challenges underpinning food conservation, rewilding, deforestation, even reforestation. And beaver reintroduction is no exception. We advocate for giving rivers space, a buffer zone to help reduce those beaver human conflicts and really maximize the potential benefits from their return. The reason I've chosen this image on the slide is that I think it's worth considering what beavers can help us achieve if we give them space to build dams and restore wet woodland. The graphic on the left is actually from research in the States about using beaver dams to restore incised stream ecosystems, and it's really interesting. And the image on the right is one of those restored channels. Now, I'm not going to talk for long because we've got a 4-minute animation. I'm delighted to screen this today, playing for the first time. It's by stop motion artist Lauren Cook, and it's really aiming to catalyze the conversation around river buffers.
Thank you. I think we should be just coming up.
A river doesn't just carry water, it carries life. For millennia, rivers have shaped the landscape around them, threading together a rich tapestry of intertwined land and habitats buzzing with life. Rivers are living beings, and we depend on them for our survival. A vital source of fresh water, crucial in farming and food production, and for all life, source to sea. But humans have forced huge change on river systems. We have straightened, dredged, and scraped them. Their edges squeezed, cleared, or paved. They are polluted, pumped with human waste, and damaged nearly beyond recovery. As one of the most nature-depleted countries in the world, we must drastically improve our riverscapes, reconnect these lost corridors for wildlife, and let nature help us adapt to this changing world. Imagine if our rivers became the clean, verdant veins of the countryside again, a healthy haven for nature's recovery and a foundation to rebuild climate-resilient lives. There is a way to achieve this by making space for water alongside rivers and streams, allowing them to return to their natural shape and flow. Once we step back our human activities, river habitats will start to regenerate, and this can take many different forms, from lush floodplain meadows to narrow wet woodlands, scrubby beaver wetlands over a cascade of waterfalling dams, to other pockets of habitat now rare in our landscape. And when we give this space to rivers, we will see benefits for wildlife, plants, and people. It creates space for streams to meander again, slowing down the flow of water and establishing habitat for aquatic plants and myriad species. Beavers will have room to restore pockets of wetland and headwaters, absorbing increased rainfall like a sponge, reducing flooding downstream and holding water back to remain lush and green in periods of drought. River woodlands will add vital cooling for aquatic life during heat waves as temperatures soar. Scrubby, wooded and restored edges will help buffer against agricultural runoff, reducing pollution and improving water quality. Wildlife corridors will re-establish valuable connectivity in our fragmented landscape. And reconnecting river channels with their floodplains will help absorb increasing rainfall, reducing flood risk for people. Rivers are nature's highways, connecting habitats, communities and freshwater networks. Their health is critical to our survival, and we need to understand that they are much more than just the channel of water we see. They need space to adapt and evolve, and need us to step back to allow their natural function. This single action will offer many benefits. By making space for water and allowing our rivers to evolve freely, more water will be held in the landscape, and we will not only create havens for diverse wildlife, but also lay the foundation for freshwater resilience and adaptation to increasing flood, drought, and even wildfire events. Supporting landowners to turn this vision into a reality could ensure our rivers become the heartbeat of thriving ecosystems for us and for future generations.
Thank you. That's brilliant. I love that animation. It's nice to have some watery sounds to as part of our day. I think it's really exciting, actually, to think about and hear from the different focus that each of you bring. And it'd be great to just start off with your immediate reflections between you on the animation. I mean, maybe Eva, do you want to kick off as it's your animation and how you feel it reflects what you do as an organisation?
It's been a really interesting challenge to put it together because, and as you and I have discussed many times, Tessa, it's such a complex subject. At one level, a very simple message, you know, give water space to operate, rivers space to manoeuvre. But the nuance of doing that is so complex, and every single situation, the devolved policy around that in each of the different nations in Britain just instantly makes this a very challenging subject. So I think what the animation has achieved, I hope it has, is sort of to talk about the potential, bring enough of the benefits and the challenges into the conversation, and enough of a sort of hope that there is some form of solution, because I think everyone's very well aware of the challenges the landscape faces and our rivers face at the moment, and I think the more solutions we can present, the better, and hopefully it does that nicely. And there's some lovely comments coming through on the chat, so we'll try and make those that available on our YouTube channel very soon.
Yeah, I can see lots of positivity coming through on the chat. Guy, how about you? How does that animation sort of tie in with the kind of work you're doing?
Yeah, so I think it was just maybe a very short section, but it was something that was really key for us, and it's like the water temperature, riparian woodlands, and how that's facilitated through beaver reintroductions. We're a grade one salmon river in, up here on the Fintorn. It's an economic, very important river for a lot of the estates around here. And yet every year we're losing our spring run to Saprolegnia, which is a fungal-like disease on salmon that comes from high water temperatures. Principally, our upland burns are completely absent of any riparian woodland. And these are our salmon spawning burns that, as a result, if you get you're managing to get salmon all the way up these rivers, often 70 miles up the rivers, and then they're succumbing at that stage to high water temperatures. It's a serious issue, both ecologically, but also economically. How you do that quite yet with beavers here is yet to be seen, because we haven't got that many trees, but we're trying to change that, and maybe that will hopefully provide some food and damming material for the beavers in the future.
Fantastic. Emma, what are your immediate thoughts?
It's just a fabulous animation. I absolutely love it. And it mentions floodplain meadows, so that's really nice to see that as part of the potential mosaic of habitats that can be used to help buffer river systems. And so I suppose I just wanted to kind of highlight that it flags floodplain meadows, and that this is an agricultural system, so we don't have to move away totally from an agricultural system in floodplain, which is a very naturally productive system, and that a mosaic, I guess, is what's in reality hopefully we'll end up with, because the options that you choose for restoration are totally dependent on geography, geology, landowner opportunity and interests, and all of those different factors. So there's a whole suite of things that we need to think about. And finally, of course, beavers. And I'm fascinated to learn more about how we can see how beavers will impact on water levels, whether they'll create opportunities for more floodplain meadows as they put more floodplains back into connection with the wider hydrological system. So yeah, it's absolutely brilliant. Lots more to talk about, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. I just want to jump to one of the questions that's come in, Emma, for you. How would you transition from a cereal crop to a floodplain meadow? How long would that take? And how would that be considered and measured in the biodiversity metric?
Well, that could be a very long answer to this question. We could take a whole site visit to discuss it. I mean, I'm happy to go and talk to people on site.
Maybe just the highlights.
Yeah. yes, it's restoration from arable. Of course, it's possible. You need to understand what your soil fertility levels are, because floodplain meadows need a reasonably low soil fertility to get that diversity of species. So getting some data on your soil fertility and your soil structure and what your hydrological regime is, this can all be done relatively simply. How long will it take? To restore a meadow, the academics say, you know, you're looking at 100 years plus if you want a full ecological functioning system. But if you just want to establish a permanent grassland with some of the indicator species in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 years, so you can see quite a quick improvement. Obviously, that's not the full functioning ecosystem. And I can't answer about the biodiversity metric because I'm not familiar enough with it to give you any detail on that.
Yeah, I'm sure there are people around the trust who might be able to help you with that. We've been doing a lot of work on biodiversity net gain and in different water systems. So if anyone wants to know more, maybe try Tom Gall. It might be the first point of contact, and he'll be able to put you in touch with the right person at the trust who might be able to help on that at least. Eva, just come, there's another question. Well, there's a couple of questions maybe I'll wrap together for you in the Q&A. So there's Sabina asks, how much space does a beaver need? But then Toby Hull is asking about heavily incised channels, and he's often wondered how beavers would cope with damming in heavily incised channels so that they're stable under flood flows, and with respect to them being able to use trees which are on perched banks, how beavers overcome those challenges. So maybe sort of those two questions sort of put together.
I'll do my best with them. So there's a statistic that sort of suggests 90% of beaver activity is within 20 metres of a shoreline. It's hugely context dependent, and the topography will make a massive difference and things like that. So it's really hard to say exactly, but they are much more efficient in water. So they don't want to trek miles over land and up slopes. They will stay in the river if they can, and if there's sufficient forage around the river, they're not going to travel terribly far once they're settled in a territory. So that's hopefully an answer, broad answer to Emma's question. Then Toby, this is something I'm learning a lot myself, and I'm going to post a link to the research report because it's really interesting. But essentially what happens is it's a long-term change, stream evolution, and sometimes it could be started with beaver dam analogs. So people put log jams in the rivers first, and what happens either with humans doing that or with beavers is that side streams form and effectively start to widen that channel, hence the need for space for this to happen. And then in doing so, that slows the flow, there's more sedimentation, more damming can happen, and eventually the river channel starts to fill in, and beavers will dam more and more, and the sediment is trapped behind their dams, and vegetation grows, and then eventually over time that creates reconnects the water level with the floodplain. So, but it's a fascinating article, and I think it's something that would be very interesting to consider over here. And for me, the context of all of this has to be extreme weather change that we're facing with the climate crisis. And I think that we've seen some major flooding recently, and very interesting to talk to Emma about this and floodplains. But you know, even sort of people saying a beaver's causing all this, you know, it's extreme rain beyond anything that beavers can do. And I think that looking at all this and looking at what our river channels are, our river floodplains are, and how much space we give them is really important.
Thank you. Yeah. It's fascinating. And I'm sure if you can put that link in the chat, there's a lot of people that would be interested in seeing that. Guy, I just wanted to ask you about the work you're doing in Findhorn and how you're sort of integrating into agricultural production or other production. Obviously, salmon is a big industry probably in the area. You know, Emma's spoken a bit about the sort of, you know, the floodplain meadows, obviously incorporating productivity into that. And, you know, we've heard a lot throughout the day from the interaction with agriculture and alongside restoration. Just hear a bit about that in the Findhorn and what you're doing there.
Yeah, so we're a bit of an old catchment, to be perfectly honest with you. We start up in the Mona Lisa, which is dominated by the high ground is deer forest, basically. And by that, I mean absent of trees, purely a deer forest in the old sense of the word. And then down through that is grouse moors with a small amount of agricultural ground set aside for sheep. And then we get heavily into forestry and basically there's very little in terms of agriculture, even right down to the mouth of the river. The majority of our work at the moment tends to be around grouse moors. Scotland is going through a shift with its grouse moors with the licensing that's just come in, which is quite an interesting change. A lot of people are re-evaluating how they might manage the land, and with that there is amazing opportunities for us for rivers. And so one of the things we're working on at the moment is sheep are used extensively on grouse moors as a tick mop. Basically sheep need to be everywhere all at once if you want to reduce tick loading on your grouse. And so the opportunities for us there to be able to say, well, you don't want your sheep down in the low ground in the rivers, so we'll potentially work out a way of providing fencing for you, and if that can be done strategically to keep sheep out of riparian areas but at a landscape scale rather than just specific areas of waterway, that can potentially help that grouse more in a way that might benefit them, but has a direct impact for us, because we then don't get sheep coming down into the river, depositing insecticides into the river, and all the consequences as a result. There's the whole deer question, which is a massive thing, especially in Scotland at the moment, and we're working quite closely with managers there, and we're actually involved in the production of a deer management strategy across the catchment, which is something I never thought we'd really do as a Rivers Trust. Quite an odd thing for us to get involved in. But deer management in the uplands has been quite well established. They've got deer management groups, but as you move through to the lowlands, it just goes. So there's an economic arm to that, but also sort of the riparian woodland creation arm. And that's sort of something that we're trying to host and sort of bring forward. I didn't really answer the question because we don't really deal with too much of the agricultural side of things like you would in the English context or the Welsh or Northern Irish or the borders for that matter.
Yeah, interesting. Thank you. I wanted to ask a bit about sort of the cultural heritage in each of your work areas, because I think there's really interesting, you know, for each of you in slightly different ways, maybe. So I don't know, Emma, do you want to kick off?
Yes, yeah, absolutely. Well, I mean, obviously, as I already said, meadows are a cultural system, or a cultural agricultural system. And we've been doing some historic research recently, which shows that many lowland floodplains were meadow around 200 years ago. They were one of the most highly valued land uses in the Domesday Book as well. So we're pretty confident that much of the lowland system was exploited for its natural fertility to create this fabulous productive hay crop. And it was shared across the local communities. so, you know, everybody got a little bit of the hay. So what we're looking at the moment is to understand more about whether populations 1,000 years ago were dependent on the amount of floodplain meadow it was possible to create in a river system, or whether it's the other way around, whether more floodplain meadows meant that there was a bigger population. So it's a really interesting area of research. But what it does show is that these systems have been in use for a very long time, up to 1,000 years. There's evidence further back than that in some cases. And of course, people's interaction with all our natural landscapes is as old as people. And I think that it's good for us to recognise and appreciate that what we see in the landscape today that is good, a lot of it is partly come about by interaction with people. And rivers are really a fabulous example of that. Systems that we've created, of course, some things aren't great, but there's lots of things to celebrate. We've used the kind of exploring of cultural history around floodplain meadows to engage with public groups, community groups, and landowners are really interested in talking about how their systems have been farmed in the past. And if you're dealing with a big estate, they may have estate maps that can tell you a really interesting story about that land. So I think we're keen to understand historic land use before we kind of launch into what we might like to change, because taking some of that into account is probably quite important.
Thank you. Yeah, it raises sort of fascinating questions, doesn't it? And Arlene kicked off the day talking about baselines and what we see as, you know, his baseline compared to his son's baseline in terms of the number of salmon, you know, that he expects to see in a river, and you know, years before you would have had something, a different view as well. And, you know, where we place that baseline is really interesting, I think. Eva, did you want to say anything about the sort of cultural?
Yeah, there's lots of really interesting stuff on beavers and culture, because of course they've been here for so long, until we hunted them to extinction in Britain. From, you know, they're a native species, so they were totally extinct from Britain, but they were down to about 1,200 in Europe, and they've come back to sort of 1.5 million now. But they were really fundamental in the fur trade, and woven into our colonial history, which I think is a really fascinating topic to explore. You know, beavers are an amazing lens for education, and this is a good example, but they're also in place names across Britain. So we've just restored some beavers to the Wyre Forest, which is a Forestry England site. And just downstream on the Severn is the Barbourne and Beaver Island, and these sort of place names that still exist. And so there's some very fascinating local history when you look at beavers. But one of my favourite things that I learned through exploring beavers is the connection with Alice in Wonderland. So beavers' pelts were used for felting and making felt hats. And the process involved lots of mercury, which sent people crazy, hence the Mad Hatter thing. And that was connected with beavers. So I thought that was quite nice. And if anyone didn't make that cultural connection, then there's a little nugget for you today.
I'd heard about the mercury in the, but I hadn't realised that it was related particularly to beaver pelts.
It's probably not just beaver pelts, but it certainly was used for them.
Yeah. Interesting. Guy, I imagine there's some strong cultural attachments in the Findhorn.
Yeah, so one thing, we've been doing all sorts of different things, but one that I sort of wanted to draw attention to, which is we're really proud of, which was working with a couple of human ecology researchers in our upper catchment to look at a lot of the Gaelic place names that we have in the Monmouth here. And then understanding those, what they mean, and how that can inform us moving forward. But as part of that, the two researchers had a deep dive into the Edinburgh archives to see where the Findhorn, the river, the salmon sort of cropped up in folk songs. And we brought those back to life and presented those to the local communities in partnership with Julie Fowlis, quite famous singer-songwriter. And it went down a treat, and it was absolutely beautiful. Everybody loved it. And a lot of that is sort of that connection, reigniting that connection that people feel is maybe being lost from our uplands, is critical. And sort of already getting requests to show it again at different things, and hopefully that will sort of be put out more widely. I'm excited. Hopefully it'll be really positive, and whether we can bring that. It's quite interesting because our catchment's split up into two very distinct areas. We've got a very Gaelic landscape in the uplands and the lowlands, which are more Pictish dominated, and how those two different things sort of coexist, and maybe there's different things we can do in the lowlands. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, the cultural, spiritual link that people have to their rivers is kind of fascinating, isn't it? And do you know what the etymology of the name Findhorn is, Guy? I feel like there must
Well,
be.
I've got it written there. So there's the Finn Dern is what it would be in Gaelic. And then, so we have Strath Dern, but then that's basically an anglicised version of that. And it's become Findhorn. But I think Finn Dern means White River, but we've got a lot of very, I'm going to get told off if Ranich is watching this, he's our Gaelic researcher, I've got it wrong. but I think that's what it is. We've got a lot of big rapids. We've got huge, if anyone's not visited it, the Findhorn, the lower Findhorn is absolutely incredible, especially for if you're into big kayaking. A lot of very big, amazing salmon jumping pools. And so yeah, it has a lot of white connotations, White River. It's ironic considering it flows off heavily degraded uplands, which are just depositing peat into the Moray Firth at a rapid speed. But there's a small portion where it goes very bubbly, and so hence the name, the White River.
Ah, interesting. Sorry, I put you on the spot there. I hope I haven't.
Probably got it wrong. I think that's what it
Well, you sounded convincing to me. So.
great book by Jamie Whittle, where he walks it from source to sea, and it's called The White River. So.
Right. Fantastic. So moving on to slightly more prosaic things then, from, you know, the cultural heritage and the spiritual. What about incentives that are available, or, you know, might be available, or what are the limitations and opportunities for incentives in each of your areas? I don't know, Eva, do you want to kick off?
I can try. Yes. So as I said at the start, the financial incentives are a devolved issue, and we're starting to see some interesting, there's talk of interesting payments for making space for water and buffer zones from Natural England for this summer. Whether or not they will be widely available, I don't know. But I think that, you know, given the variety of land use around water's edges and the variety of opportunity, we know that they're going to have to be high to be attractive payments and incentives for making space for water. River buffers are part of the national strategy in Scotland around beavers, and you know, so they're recognised as a part of a solution, and I think it's really interesting to see where the incentives will go. We talk a lot within the Riverscapes Partnership, looking at buffers, about whether or not is financially incentivizing is enough, whether or not we need to look at it. And again, it's always very context dependent. You know, how big relatively is that area of land for the farm? If it's a stream at the bottom of a, you know, massive estate, that's not going to make a massive difference. If it's a 100-acre farm and it runs straight through the middle, it might make a material difference. So that payment needs to be huge, respectively. So it's really hard to, it's a hard one to crack. But I think that it needs to be tied into, you know, the public benefit, the conservation benefit, the need for it is biodiversity and climate resilience, and that's really clear and really important for not just farmers but communities downstream. And I think one of the really interesting areas, which I'm not massively well versed on in terms of what payments are available, is water storage. And so water storage in the landscape, the concept of water batteries, you know, is I think hopefully where things are going to go, because we need to, despite the floods at the moment and the excessive rain we've had this winter, you know, we're going to need to store more water in the landscape. And there's a really interesting report out from Spain's Hall by the Environment Agency just this month about the 10-acre beaver enclosure there, which managed to store 3 million litres of water over 9 dams. And that's, you know, that's an example where DEFRA are getting involved in the research, and there are biodiversity payments going on there as well. But it's, I think that's a really interesting area for financial incentives, is water storage.
Yeah, as you say, you know, at the moment we're very focused on the floods, aren't we? And there's so much water everywhere. But, you know, I know I sit on one of the national drought groups, and, you know, the message is always we're only ever one dry period away from a drought. And because of the nature of the way that the water rushes out through our rivers, you know, we always need more to slow that flow and hold more water in our rivers and groundwaters. to combat the dry periods that are inevitably going to come as well. So, Emma, you touched a bit on some of the incentives around meadows. What are the opportunities or limitations of that? What else needs to be done?
Well, so DEFRA announced, as Eva also said, in January, a new suite of stewardship options. And we've been working with DEFRA for some time now on developing a specific floodplain meadow option that's sort of within this wider suite of species-rich grasslands, but separate, because the management needs of floodplain meadows are somewhat different to those of drier grasslands. And that seems to be being picked up. And although we haven't seen the detail behind the headline, we do have the financial figures, in as much as they've said this £1,040 per hectare for floodplain meadow management and restoration. So I think that reflects all those benefits that I talked about in floodplain meadows. Obviously, that's just for England, and we don't know anything about whether there's going to be any restrictions applied to that, or whether it's only going to be over a certain area or whatever. They say that we'll find out more in the summer. But the headline is pretty eye-catching, and we've had quite a lot of farmer clusters and facilitators come and say, we're really interested in this, obviously, compared to what it used to be, which was like £182 a hectare kind of thing. It's a huge jump for species-rich grass and creation. So it's a massive opportunity, and it'll be a massive incentive if it's applied widely across the country. We're also obviously talking to the Welsh government about their current sustainable farming scheme consultation and sharing our experiences from working with DEFRA, and hoping that they'll go down a similar sort of route. We haven't really touched much on the policy environment in Scotland, although we have done some work on the Western Isles of Scotland on the wet grasslands next to the, as part of the MacAir systems. We're doing some research on understanding how those systems function, and until we've got a better understanding, we won't start to feed into policy change in Scotland. So that's slightly dependent on a bit more research. So I feel like, although things aren't great, and obviously the weather changes aren't great, what they are doing is making a lot of farmer groups think this isn't working now. Here's an incentive. Here's something else we can try. That seems to be the story.
Yeah. No, it's fascinating. And I think the CS Plus incentives, the ELM schemes that have come out this January, there is serious money in all of the water related and water restoration related incentives, which is, really encouraging that they're seeing that as a strong opportunity. But as you say, the devil will be in the detail when it comes to actually how they're implemented and applied. Guy, do you get involved in incentives a lot in Scotland, and how are they impacting on the work that you're doing?
Yeah, so we're quite lucky in that we've got quite a large grant from the Scottish Government for a couple of years. It's the Just Transition Fund. So that quite a lot of that is core capital funds that we can use as we see fit. We've also been able to draw down on a partnership with the Shivers Brothers whiskey people, who basically want to see riparian woodlands at scale, and who are willing to put in the money to facilitate that. And the way that works is we will basically go to a landowner, talk to them about it, about what we might want to see. And if they're happy for that, we can go and find the funds to be able to fund that 100% if we think it's got value. Say there should be some, if there's some compromises down the road in terms of what the landowner might want to see, then we can change that contribution. But we do have bespoke agreements that act as what we call land stewardship agreements that the stewards of the land can enter into with us and take that forward to deliver that for the next generation, basically.
So we've talked quite a lot about the sort of different things you're doing sort of independently, but there must be opportunities, I think, for the work that you're doing interactively as well. Eva, I know you and Emma possibly have been talking a bit about that. Do you want to pick up on that, how they can kind of feed into each other, the different solutions? Don't know which one of you wants to pick that up first. I'll let you fight it out.
It's a mosaic. I mean, it's a horses for courses to a certain extent, isn't it? You know, we've got different options here. We've got headwater options. We've got lowland systems. We've got, you know, beavers and who knows where they'll end up, you know, making their homes eventually. So I think, you know, when we talked about this before, there are so many different opportunities if you can find something that makes it work for the landowner. And that's always going to be the sort of the overriding objective. In any one particular place. We just did a project on the Windrush looking at a floodplain meadow strategy along the Windrush because there was a lot of interest from the farming community there and sort of developed a fairly interesting technique from our perspective of how to decide what habitat might be best in what place depending on the soil physics. And I think it would be very interesting to talk to Eva and Guy about those kind of techniques and whether you guys have sort of similar approaches to looking.
Oh, might have lost her for a bit there. Very dramatic. Eva, maybe do you want to come in while we're retrieving her?
Oh, that's a pity. Well, I think it's a good opportunity to mention the Riverscapes Partnership. So it's a partnership between National Trust, Rivers Trust, Beaver Trust and Woodland Trust. And the idea behind that is that we're all trying to work to the same end, which is that once you give space for water along riverscapes, whatever is appropriate for that area can then be achieved. And yes, it needs to be adequately incentivized for the landowner, but it might help them. So some of the research that we did back in January last year was sort of that the river buffer zone might be really helpful in areas that are nigh on unfarmable anyway on that patch, because you can't get your boom spray around that corner or something like that, you know. So there are joint wins to be had if you work together. And I think that what we talk a lot about is that certainly in the NGO world, you know, the end goal is often very aligned. What we all want is ecosystem restoration for whatever that context needs to be. And if we come at it from loads and loads of different angles, the policymakers, the public, the land managers will just get overwhelmed and confused by it, and no one's going to adopt anything. So if we work together, I think that's a really important message, I think, with all of this. And I think, yeah, there's loads of scope for the beaver conversation in all these other projects. I mean, beavers are very impactful species. Our hope is that they will return as a naturally native animal in the wild across England, Scotland and Wales. And that is going to impact land use and river use, and hopefully for the better. But in certain locations, there are going to be challenges with that. We have management systems available and a hierarchy of management techniques. So they can be handled when those impacts are not wanted. But I think it's a question of doing a lot of talking and adapting together. And while we do that, we're trying to also face sort of major climate adaptation. So it's such an interesting time to be working in this area.
Yeah, and as you say, it's absolutely not a one fix suits all situation. Emma, sorry, we lost you there as you were. I think maybe you'd almost come to the end of what you were saying, but was there anything you wanted to add on just to finish up?
Only that I'm interested in picking up sites where beavers might be active to see what impact they're having on soil groundwater levels and a possible relationship to floodplain meadow restoration.
Yeah, brilliant. We're very, very nearly out of time, but one quick last question, Guy, for you, just about how you see the balance of grouse shooting in its kind of, you know, clearing the land as opposed to tree cover and wilder riparian areas to cool water?
That's a great question because it comes up quite a lot with us. I think basically, I'll try to be really succinct. We don't own land. There are people that do. It's a perfectly legitimate legal thing to do, grouse moor management. If I owned land, maybe I wouldn't do it like that. But there's ways of working with people that will produce the benefits that we want to see. And that's through incentivized work, open channels of discussion, trust. And then there are ways that we can find little middle ground. And that might be they're struggling with getting the sheep down into the riparian areas and they don't want that. We've got a bit of money to fund that. And then we can see, you know, what we'll help you through that process. And it would be easy for us to say, we don't agree with that. And we would do it differently. But there's a sort of pragmatic approach to working with the people that own the land. And if you, we have a thing that's slightly cliched, but change happens at the speed of trust. And if you lose trust of a landowner because you just don't agree with them, you've just shut the door to maybe 10,000 hectares. And that's a huge portion of our catchment that we might shut ourselves out to. But yes, riparian woodland is incredibly important. I think personally, they can go hand in hand with grouse moors. And with our licensing up in Scotland, that there might be opportunities to make that more formalised. But at the moment, that it's through goodwill and incentives, basically.
Well, thank you so much, all of you. I think we're pretty much out of time. I think there's a couple of things that really jump out at me from that session, and you know, there've been sort of messages throughout the day. And I really like that what you just said there, Guy, about change happens at the speed of trust. You know, it's very much a philosophy of the Rivers Trust is to collaborate and work together with others, and you know, we won't get anywhere if we try and impose things on people. And that sort of also feeds into the, you know, there is not one size that fits all. And so it's really, really important, I think, that the incentives that we have are flexible and adaptable and equitable. And, you know, that is something that I think, you know, we're keen to push for in the work that we do with Riverscape. So really, really thank you, all of you, for your input. And I'll hand back to Becca for the ending bit of the day.
Thanks, Tessa, and thanks to all of the panelists as well. Another brilliant panel session to bring us almost to a close. There's been so much insight, so much knowledge, so much expertise shared today. And I think one thing for me to highlight is that this may be the end of the day, but it's not the end of the conversation. On river buffers, we're going to be going away on the Rivers Trust team. We're going to be reflecting. We'll share the recordings from today, and we'll really think about how this can inform our work going forward, and you know, how we can work with our movement on that as well. But moving on, we are going to come to our closing remarks. And for those of you who were here earlier today for Mark Lloyd's opening remarks, you will remember that one of the highlights for us this year was the bringing on board for the first time of our Rivers Trust ambassadors. So I'm really pleased that two of our four ambassadors are joining us for the closing remarks today. First of all, we are going to hear from Jack Perks, who's a wildlife cameraman. He's a broadcaster, he's got a book coming out, and he's also a very keen angler. So Jack's been really kind to send a recording in. So I'm just going to play that first, and then we'll move on to Imogen, who's just joined us as well. So first of all, we'll hear from Jack.
My name's Jack Perks, and I'm a professional wildlife photographer, cameraman, and all-round river nut. And I'm going to be talking a little bit about river buffers and why they're so important. We're in a climate and biodiversity crisis. Currently within government, there's no unifying strategy or indeed clarity as to how we're going to get out of this quite frankly terrible situation that we find ourselves with our rivers. The status quo is not working. Something needs to change. To improve the environment, we need to work with existing natural processes. Myself and the Rivers Trust think this should be done on a catchment-based level, starting with the rivers, their margins, and the freshwater environment around them. There's no better place to start than the river buffer. But what is a river buffer? Well, essentially, it's the strip of land between the water and the bank here. This creates fantastic habitat. You're going to get wildflowers growing in here, things like marsh marigold, water mint. That in turn provides nectar for invertebrates. They feed the bats, the birds, and of course the fish. So you create a mini highway of biodiversity. It's easy to do. You just let the land grow and the plants come up. Now the clue's in the name. It's a river buffer. So it's buffering against problems that are going to face the river. Whether that's people trampling the bank sides, cattle, dogs, etc. It's also a buffer against agricultural pollution, intensive pollution. Those plants are going to help stop that entering the waterway. These buffers also act as a net of sorts, catching litter, which can then be collected rather than be washing downstream. In agricultural areas, moving active production and management back from the river's edge allows rivers to expand and move. We know that walking along rivers is incredibly beneficial for our mental health. I know from my own experience, I'm a little bit stressed or a little bit down, that walking along some water is a fantastic tonic for the mind and helps clear those kind of stressful thoughts. We know that river buffers are not going to solve all the problems. Of course they're not, there are too many, but they're a great place to start. They're easy to create, they increase biodiversity quickly, and they're great to look at. So what's not to like?
So thank you to Jack there for sharing that lovely video with, as expected from a cameraman, amazing visuals. And we are going to share that video on our social media and on our YouTube as well, so you can watch it again. And now I'm really pleased to introduce someone who you may have seen on your TV screens recently, or if you haven't yet, then hopefully you will be later in the summer, as Imogen Grant, who is a world champion rower and is all set to represent Team GB at this summer's Olympic Games, is now going to deliver our next closing remarks. So thank you so much, Imogen.
Thanks, Rebecca. I mean, it's been an amazing conference, and listening to all the passionate people that have been speaking today about river buffers and preserving our rivers within the UK has been really inspiring for someone like me. As Arlen was speaking about this morning, the Ambassador Programme for the Rivers Trust is quite new, and it's a privilege to be one of the first. But with that comes a lot of learning, and I've certainly learned an awful lot over the 6 or 7 months that I've been working with the Rivers Trust so far. I'm a rower, so I spend an awful lot of time on waterways, on lakes and on rivers, and it's something that's really close to my heart. Living far away from a river now would be unthinkable. I think I need that green space, and I know that I'm preaching to the choir when I say that as well. I'm not an expert when it comes to rivers, but I am an expert when it comes to rowing and rowing outings. So I thought I'd paint you the image of two different outings I've had. The first one was mid-morning, middle of the day. I was out in my single, my one-person rowing boat, and I was rowing along, and along the sides of the bank, there was just, I could see the orange of Sainsbury's bags just hanging in the trees. I could see white tatters. I could see a nappy hanging caught in one of the branches. The water was brown. It was foamy. And at some point, I had to dodge a fridge that was floating down the middle of the river. Not a great picture. Bit of a stressful outing. The second outing I want to describe was fairly recently. There was an absolutely gorgeous sunrise that was just coming over the tops of the trees. The light reflecting off the water was perfect. It was one of those mornings where you had heavy cloud cover, but the sun was coming in underneath, so it was filled with this amazing orange glow. I could see the birds feeding. There was ducks and pigeons and some swans swimming around. And I was lucky enough that outing as well to spy a seal that came swimming next to me for a little bit. A little bit intimidating when you're in a very small rowing boat and the seal is probably twice the weight of you and about as long as the boat that you're in. But it was an absolutely incredible moment and experience, and it felt really, really special. Both of those experiences happened on the same river. For me, they happened on the Thames. But I'm sure that resonates with a lot of you, thinking about your own rivers and thinking about them when they are so beautiful and so fulfilling, and thinking about them when they feel choked and struggling. And we've all been here today talking about how to make that better together. The river buffers, working with landowners, working with farmers, bringing in all of these different people who can make a difference towards this goal. As a sports person, it's one of those things that I feel like I want to bring my expertise in, and I might not know rivers as well, though I'm learning, but I do know sport. And some of the things that we take from sport are certainly the things that we can apply to this as well. the thing that I want to share with you today is the concept of an unattainable goal. It's something that I found really motivating in my sporting life. There was a race where I wasn't selected into the boat that I wanted to be racing in. I'd been in that boat the previous World Championships and done very well, but someone had come in and I was busy doing something else. And so the coach has said to me, look, you're not in this boat for this regatta, but you are in the single. And so I turned around and said, fine, I'm going to go set a world best time. I had no idea if it was possible. It was an unattainable goal. It was something so lofty and so ridiculous that it almost sounded laughable to mention. But what it did was kind of take the pressure off. I knew that it probably wasn't within my control to achieve that goal. In rowing, you need a tailwind, you need flat water, you need warm water, and all of those things were outside of my control. But by setting that goal of trying to set a world record, trying to go the fastest that a single had ever gone, I started putting in place the small things that were going to at least make me better, if not set me on my way to that goal. And the interesting thing was, I knew that I was getting better anyway. And somewhere along the way, that unattainable goal didn't seem quite so unattainable. And I got lucky, and I did. I set a world best time a couple of months later. And it wasn't because I set that goal, it was because of all of the steps that I'd taken on the way to achieving it. The way to solve the problem with the rivers, I think, can feel like an unattainable goal. But I say, why not? Why not set that as that ridiculous goal? Why can't we decide to say, okay, every river should have a river buffer? And we probably know that might not be completely possible, but think of the possibilities that our minds open up to if we set that as the goal and see what sets out along the way, along our steps to achieving it. And we might surprise ourselves as well. To close out and to bring this full circle, given that the conference started with some fantastic poetry, I have a poem here that was written by Ona Haynes, who is the niece of Arlen Rickard, who began this conference today. So I'd like you all to join me while I read it out and we finish the day of this fantastic conference. The poem is called Without Water. Without water, spring would never be sprung again. Autumn would have no mist. Winter would have no snow, and Jack Frost would be made redundant. Without water, rainforests would have no rain and no forests. April would have no showers, and Niagara would have no falls. Without water, who could go anywhere under their own steam? And what would carve a valley through the mountains? Without water, drinks and rinks would have no ice. Wishing wells couldn't grant a splash, let alone a wish. Gulls would have no sea. Ducks would have no pond. Beavers would have no brooks. Toads would have no lily pads. Lap dogs would have nothing to lap. Peat would have no bog, and you couldn't even lead your horse to water, let alone make it drink. Without water, crops would come a cropper. No fisherman would ever tell or catch another whopper. Without water, despite your sorrows and fears, you couldn't cry a river because you wouldn't have the tears. Thanks for coming, everybody.
Imogen, thank you so much. That was a really fantastic end to the conference. And I don't want to ruin the perfection of that by talking too much, but I'll just say thanks again. I'm sure that, well, we've got a few international joinees today, so I can't guarantee that everyone will be cheering on Team GB, but I'm sure everyone can get behind you as a person and your support for the Rivers Trust. We really appreciate it so much. And then just really quickly, I am going to say thank you to all of the speakers who have joined us today. Everyone at the Rivers Trust team who's just really worked hard to pull it together, especially my backstage helpers, Matthew and Gabs, who you won't have seen, but they've been here all day and they've been fantastic. And finally, to all of you attendees who have come, you've listened, you've shared your stories, and you have just been part of a wonderful day. And we hope to see you all again soon. Thanks and have a wonderful evening.